Good morning. My name is Sean Hudgenwortel, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name, and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane. A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. Welcome back. And that will be followed by a selection of music. Today's scripture lesson will be Genesis, the first chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good morning. Good morning. It's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for allowing me to be here this beautiful day, Sunday, and same as the other people attending classes. Thank you for all the understanding of this beautiful teaching you laid down for us for our salvation. I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Our scripture lesson will be taken from Genesis, the first chapter, page 1. And I'll be reading out the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities in various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. Genesis, the first chapter. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters. And Elohim said, Let there be light, and there was light. And Elohim saw the light, that it was good. And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness. And Elohim called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And Elohim said, Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. And Elohim made the firmament, and divided the waters which was under the firmament from the waters which was above the firmament. And it was so. And Elohim called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. And Elohim said, Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And Elohim called the dry portion earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And Elohim saw that it was good. And Elohim said, Let the earth bring forth tender grass, the herb yielding seed, the fruit trees yielding fruit after its kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth tender grass, herb yielding seed after his kind, and tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And Elohim saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day. And Elohim said, Let the lights in the firmament of the heavens separate the day from the night. And they will be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And Elohim made to appear two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. And Elohim set them in the firmament of the heaven to lighten the earth and to rule by day and by night, and to separate between light and between darkness. And Elohim saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the fourth day. And Elohim said, let the water swarm with swarms of living creatures and birds that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of the heavens. And Elohim created great sea monsters and every living creature that swarmed, with which the water swarmed after their kind, and every winged bird after his kind. And Elohim saw that it was good. And Elohim blessed them, saying, be fruitful and increase, and fill the waters in the seas, and let the birds multiply in the earth. And the evening and the morning were the fifth day. And Elohim said, let the earth bring forth the living creatures after his kind, cattle and creeping things, and beasts of the earth after their kind. And it was so. And Elohim made beasts of the earth after their kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the ground after their kind. And Elohim saw that it was good. And Elohim said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So Elohim created man in his image. In the image of Elohim created he him. Male and female created he him. And Elohim blessed him, and Elohim said unto him, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. And Elohim said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed. To you it shall be for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to every creeping thing upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for food. And it was so. And Elohim saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed, and all their hosts. And on the seventh day, Elohim completed his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And Elohim blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his works which Elohim created and made. I have read Genesis, the first chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Good morning again. Thank you, Dr. Salas and Dr. Reiser. Today's Sunday, and for our first speaker, I would like to call Dr. Samuel Salas.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
It's a privilege and happiness to me to be here. I was not feeling so well for a few days, but I am back. Yahweh is the one give the energy and the will, and he make war, he make peace, he caused life and caused death. So we had to see the world just roll and try to enjoy what is available for us. And what is available for us, in my perspective, is this teaching. This teaching, one man in the year 1931, he had a vision. It passed out, but it was revealed to him what we teach in this class all the time. We congregate. His name was Henry Clifford Kinley. That happened in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And after he had the vision, then he had the revelation. Like, for instance, for us, you have a vision right here. But when someone explains you what it's all about, is when you have the revelation, if you have the understanding. Because wisdom and understanding is the stability of the times. Wisdom and knowledge is the stability of the times, but understanding is the only reality exists. As simple as that. If you don't understand, it's nothing, it's gone. And let me tell you, I was thinking about this. And I've been keep saying this for a long time. Men, when I say men, I talk about women, female and male. Start to became old when he stopped learning. So we have to keep going learning, and we keep young because we, you know, it's active and our mind is keep working. Our cells and brain cells multiply. Otherwise, they die. And they, little by little, as people start having Alzheimer's, and they don't even remember the relatives. So we have to have our mind keep going, working, and try to discern and understand things we were told by the founder. The most important of the things he tried to get across to us is we have here is the first aim to help you find and know Elohim if he really is and actually exists. So with that, you come over here to these classes, the Spirit help you to have the understanding. Like when I first started coming to this teaching, I didn't know the name of the Creator. I didn't know the name of the Son. I didn't know the name of the Holy Spirit. It took a little time for me to straight those things up. Now, to me, those things are so simple, but in those days, I was confused. I was keep coming because I never heard, I never see, and I never heard about Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. Those names I never heard, and I never read. So when I start checking dictionaries and encyclopedias, as I was told, I found it out. The name of the Creator is Yahweh. I was so happy in those days Man, I was jumping into people. Hey, did you know the name of the Creator? I tried to make everybody aware of that. Even I went to Mexico. I take the charts over there in front of the Catholic Church. And and this time I cannot do it. The founder tell us, when you go someplace and try to get this teaching across another people, you have to have someone with you. Don't go alone by yourself. With protections, because you're talking about something opposite of what they believe. Because what they have is carnal ordinances. You tell them this is not working in this time, in this age, you destroy all the belief they have for salvation. And if they have a chance, they can eliminate you. You know how the evil spirit works. Well, I am not fully strong enough to sustain myself. I'm still a little weak. So I just say these things only for this time. And thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Salas. For our next speaker, I would like to call on the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love. Okay, wait.
I say anything. Good morning, class. How's everybody feeling this morning? Happy Father Days to all the fathers and single moms that are in place of fathers, huh? Doing double duty and all that. So we all have played dual roles at various times, and that's okay, because we know that we come in the likeness and image of our Creator, as we read there in Genesis 1 and 26, I believe, that He made man in the likeness and image of Yahweh Elohim, as Samuel expressed. Elohim not being a name, but a pluralistic title, a title like Lord and God, but a divine title, a title that our Creator chose for Himself. And this title is expressed on this Moses chart, right? Grab me one and one, please, John. Understand that this pluralistic title has a word and a son, which is also titles, that is a descriptive of this super incorporeal anthropomorphic being, right? Which we're going to read some about how he was created. I think I'm also going to like, I think it's Psalms 8 and 20?
Or 22.
22, yeah.
Genesis 1 and 1.
Yeah, we'll go with Genesis 1 and 1 right now, because we want to find out about that Creator that we're all created by in the likeness and image of. Right. Again, as I expressed, this is the first chapter of Genesis, and I hope to be able to go by, and we talked about it on Tuesday. What's the question?
Proverbs,
possibly, yeah, 8 and 22. Okay. About how we even get to Genesis. You know, as Samuel talked about earlier, that the known world, for the most part, still abides with Lord God and Jesus Christ. And therefore, being in this school and having been shown that it cannot be Lord God and Jesus Christ by way of the divine vision and revelation, not the man Kinley, but the vision that the man had in 1931 is what it is that we purport to expound upon and learn more clearly about how it is so that we have a Yahweh, an Elohim, and the name of a Yahshua, and how these are working in unison or unity, whereby we can have some strength and confidence, as Samuel said. The stability is in the knowledge, the wisdom and knowledge. And it is the stability by which we have a platform and a grounds to be able to say anything about our Creator in order to edify or love one another. Because that's the true love, is preaching the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. Yahweh gave his only begotten Son, John 3:16, in order to save the world. Because that was his love to do. He knew man could not perceive him in this pure spirit state, because as we say in the moderation, he's inscrutable and incomprehensible. There's no way no man could understand pure spirit. You cannot see spirit, you cannot touch spirit, you cannot hear spirit, according to our audible sounds. You see, the vibrations that we hear from my voice, and you're not hearing Yahweh in that fashion. When he saw the divine vision and revelation, he felt. But he wasn't using any of his senses. You can't taste it nor smell spirit. So therefore, how are we going to teach about spirit? Therefore, man, it behooved Yahweh in order to do what John 1:1 says.
John 1:1.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning was the Word.
Okay.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
Now, mind you, this word is the same word that we're looking at here. And we're saying that this title or super incorporeal form, shape and form, that was created before the creation was ever created was, read.
And the Word was Yahweh.
Now listen, this Word was Yahweh, not a separate entity unto itself. So this Word in this form by which he broke himself down to was Yahweh, read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
All things were made by him.
By him who? By him, Yahweh Elohim. Yahweh transformed into Elohim, and Elohim created the creation, as we know it, as we read there in John, in Genesis 1, right? So that was Elohim is what is doing the creating. Read.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Now without Elohim, everything is Yahweh in his pure spirit state. But it's by Elohim that's created everything. Dog, cat, good, bad. Elohim creating in this shape and form. Read.
In him was life.
Now in Elohim is the life, because remember John 3:16, that Yahweh gave his only begotten Son, right? And it's in through the Son or by the Son that we're going to have know anything about this Yahweh. As Samuel said, our first aim is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he truly is and actually exists. So therefore, Yahweh, knowing man cannot perceive him in this state and condition of pure spirit, had to divest and come down as a death in order to begin to manifest. And we have John 1:1 as we're reading through, that through this super incorporeal being, we're going to be able to learn something about Yahweh. Because, hey, Yahshua says that no man knows the Father or comes to the Father yet by through him. So therefore, Yahshua, which we'll get to, we're going to have to know something about Yahshua, and we're learning something about Elohim right now. which is what we can be, which can be seen because you have 73 people when we get over to Exodus talking about they saw the Elohim, right? So this is the means or the way that Yahweh's preordained that we're going to learn anything about. We're not using our opinions, our concepts or opinions or interpolations about this one, which I've labeled him as Elohim, but it's a title. It's not a name. Keep reading.
In him was life, mm-hmm. and the life was the light of men.
It's the light of men. This is the light that when we read Genesis 1 and 1, if you can grab that, that's good for John 1 and 1 because now we got the word, right? And we got where the word began, and we got that this word was the light that lighteth every man. And so we got Genesis 1 and 1. Let's read that real quick.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
Now, in the beginning now, because we went through by John and said that Elohim, before anything was created, now he's saying in the beginning, read.
Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
Now, who's writing this here?
Moses.
We have Moses, the author, or Moses, the writer of Genesis, writing about in the beginning of his vision. Not in the beginning of the creation, but in the beginning of his vision is what we're expressing here. Read.
And the earth became without form and void.
According to Moses' visions, what he had seen. Read.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep.
Now there's darkness that's on the face of the deep. And this is how Moses is writing about it. Read.
And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the water.
Now, see, the spirit, we read in our, we say in the aims, to understand by the vision and understand by revelation that this spirit, right, came down. So now we have a spirit that we're reading here in Genesis, talking about that spirit that moved. That's this Elohim. Read.
And Elohim said, let there be light.
Let there be light. That's that light that lighteth every man within each one, every one of us. And this is why we're going back to the beginning of the time and we rehearse about that light, which is Elohim, that lighteth every man. Because that was the light that shone in the darkness. So it gives us a witness as to what we're learning about, which is a light, which is a type or a shadow or a correlation where we're going to begin to build upon. So that light that's within us can begin to illuminate from out of this darkness. As Samuel stated, before he came into this teaching, he understood it as Lord God and Jesus Christ. And then as he said, having to learn about how we're not just merely substituting Lord for Yahweh and God for Elohim and Jesus for Yahshua, not straight across, because this is a Trinity. And in the Trinity, you have a title, and a name. And what we're expressing is that this is a name, a divine title, and a name. And we're not breaking these names up as individual beings.
Right.
We're not doing that. Therefore, we're not merely substituting names and titles at all. We're expressing that Yahweh divested himself in the form of Elohim. And he created the creation according to Moses' vision. And now we're going to have to get to Yahshua, because Yahshua is the Holy Spirit. And there's but one spirit, John 24 and 3. 424. 17 and 3 is the other one. So we're going to have to identify this spirit, right? Yahweh is pure spirit, incomprehensible and inscrutable. He created himself in a form, not with blood and not with flesh and blood. Right? Read.
For Elohim is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Remember, Yahweh Elohim created. So Yahweh is this spirit, and is not, and that Elohim is not a separate Holy Spirit. It's the same spirit. But what we read in John that we didn't get to, that light that lighteth every man, which was that word, John 1:14 states that this word did what?
Eunice made flesh.
Okay. I'm sorry.
That's all right.
I didn't finish.
And the word was made flesh.
Now look, this word that can only be seen by divine visions and understood by divine revelations in this form, this word did what?
Was made flesh,
mm-hmm.
and dwelt among us,
mm-hmm.
and we beheld his glory.
They saw the glory. Read.
The glory of the only begotten of the Father.
The only begotten transformed and created or became flesh and blood as Yahshua the Messiah, which was the first begotten of Yahweh. Not separate. He's incorporeal here, and he manifested once down here in Egypt at 30 years old from the son of Nun, Nun after the flesh. It's not a play on words. It's the way it's set up and the way it's written in one's Bible, that Yahshua, the son of Nun, was down here, led them through the Red Sea, tarried with them for 40 years, crossed the River Jordan, and tarried here an additional 40 years. Then he laid down his life at 110. And then now you have Yahshua the Messiah appearing at the end of the fourth dispensation, the first begotten of Yahweh, in order to manifest himself, in order to fulfill all 4,000 years of what he's instituted and set up. And so we're no longer after the cross expressing as Elohim. It's Yahshua the Messiah, which is that Holy Spirit that was poured out on the Pentecost 50 days after he's resurrected into the hearts and minds of souls who will believe. Believe what? Believe the report of how he was born of a virgin, how he was the first begotten of Yahweh before the earth was, right? And so now, Proverbs 8:23, going back again about this Elohim, so we can get an understanding of how this Elohim is working a little bit.
Proverbs 8:22.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of his way.
Possessed who? Who did Yahweh possess? This is Solomon writing in Proverbs. Is it Solomon? Because if we run over to 2 Peter 1 and 20, we see that. You grab 2 Peter 1 and say their units. You're fine.
Okay.
Because we want to make clear that it's not Solomon writing. We say the first person as though Yahweh possessed Solomon. Solomon is expressing and being in writing by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit back during the prophets. Keep reading, Eunice.
Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of his way,
mm-hmm.
before his works of old.
That's Elohim. He possessed Elohim before the works of old. This is what we had just talked about, but I'm just reiterating it through the prophets. Read.
I was set up from everlasting,
mm-hmm.
from the beginning, or ever the earth was.
Mm-hmm. So before ever the earth was, this is Elohim was set up for the purpose, the only begotten of the Father. Read.
When there was no death, I was brought forth.
Mm-hmm.
When there was no fountains abounding with water.
Mm-hmm.
Before the mountains were settled, before the hills was I brought forth.
Okay.
While as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world. When he prepared the heavens, I was there when he set a compass upon the face of the deep. When he established the cloud above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep, when he gave to the sea his decree that the waters should not pass his commandments, when he appointed the fountains of the earth, then I was by him as one brought up with him, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him.
That's Elohim. That's that word that became flesh, that dwelt amongst the people at that time for a purpose. Yahweh has a purpose. He's not doing things willy-nilly and doing things haphazardly. He's not forgotten about anybody. What we're expressing is that to know and understand Yahshua, the Messiah, because if we can go ahead and grab John 5 and 39, please, because this is how we're going to, the method by which we're going to be able to learn something about this one called Yahshua. The name of Yahshua. Yahshua simply meaning, again, Yahweh, right, is salvation. Not a separate entity or his little boy. That's not what we're expressing. This is Yahweh is salvation as Yahshua the Messiah. What is one and the same? He's a unity. He's not a trinity. Or he's not even bifold, if you would, either. You follow? This is Yahweh in a concrete form at this time of Yahshua the Messiah. Read. And I say at this time because this is Yahshua talking to the scribes and Pharisees about who he is. In this form, he's expressing thusly.
Ye search the scriptures, mm-hmm. for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Now he's telling them that you search the scriptures, and he's expressing to them during the fourth dispensation. Okay? He's reading out of a Bible with by a leaflet that says New Testament. That's not so. This is a biography report. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are simply a biography of what they experienced. They mean Matthew and John primarily. Luke and Mark were secondhand witnesses to Yahshua the Messiah. They were told what to write primarily, right? And so now we're reading John, who was an eyewitness, about what Yahshua said before he hung on the cross. And now Yahshua is saying this, that you search the scriptures. And they did have scriptures back then. They didn't have the Holy Bible. They didn't have the New Testament. They had what they had was what we express that they have the, go ahead and grab me 8 and 20 of Isaiah, please. So we got to find out what the scriptures are, because they didn't have the manuscripts that we have now. They didn't have Google. They didn't have a plethora of encyclopedias and writings. But they did have writings. And we need to express that we're talking and sharing from the vantage point of what Yahshua the Messiah thus said. And therefore, he's saying that you search the scriptures, and we need to find out what they are. Isaiah.
To the law and to the testimony. Mm-hmm. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
There go that light again. There go that light again. And if they don't have this light, there's no. Keep reading.
And they shall pass through it hard pressed and hungry.
Hard pressed and hungry. Their soul's going to be hungry because they don't have the true light in them. And they're going to want to know why they can't be sustained. And that light is the light that lighteth every man, because he wrote the law, which is the law of Moses, which is your first five books, constituting the law or the Torah. And then you have the subsequent 34 of the books written by the prophets, starting with Joshua all the way to Malachi. That's comprising of the scriptures that Yahshua the Messiah is saying here in John 5 and 39, you search the scriptures. So simply it's your old portion of your Bible. And you say you search those, then you're going to learn something about somebody. Just see what it says. Read.
And it shall come to pass that when they shall be hungry.
No. We're back at John 5 and 39.
Oh, sorry. Got it. Ye search the scriptures,
okay,
for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Now it's in them that they think they're going to have some eternal life, because they've been struggling and straining in the gnat ever since Moses. All that Moses wrote in the law is what they're trying to do and to follow. And so now we're reading Joshua saying that you search the scriptures because that's the eternal life that they want. Read.
And they are they which testify of me.
They are they, meaning the scriptures, are what is testifying to one Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
But ye will not come to me that ye might have life.
Mm-hmm.
I receive not honor from mm-hmm. men, but I know you, that ye have not the love of Elohim in you.
They don't have the love of Elohim. Now we're back to Elohim. Yahshua is talking about an Elohim now, of what state and condition he's come down from. And they won't go to him because they're looking at a physical, concrete man that was unsightly. He wasn't anything to be admired. So who are you, Yahshua from Nazareth, to tell us that we need to come to you with the scriptures that we have? Because they thought those scriptures are about them and what they needed to do in order to have eternal life. But let's find out eternal life, John 17:3. And so now we have Yahshua telling them that the scriptures are all about him. Him in the form as he was in the beginning as Elohim.
And this is life eternal.
Now this is going to be what life eternal is.
That they might know that thou art the true El.
That thou art the true El. That Yah. Can you read it out the King James, please? Do you have it?
And this is life eternal.
Mm-hmm.
That they might know that thee.
That thee. That thee who? That thee Yahweh. Read.
The only true Elohim.
The only true Elohim. Remember, Elohim is a title that's divine. And it supersedes all other gods that there were or that there are. Then and now, this is the only true El. Read.
And Yahshua the Messiah.
And Yahshua the Messiah.
Whom thou hast sent.
Whom who has sent? But Yahweh himself. Yahweh gave his only begotten son. So, and it's to know, and that know, K-N-O-W, is the same intimately know about something. It's not a know of. It's not a vain, oh, I've heard of that name before. There's an understanding that goes with the name of Yahshua. What's the meaning? You see? And that's the knowing that we come to learn about through all of these events in time, by way of a vision, not by way of a person. Because each and every tub must stand on our own bottom to know about Yahshua, which is the true Elohim. And he is the true light that lighteth every man within us. Because we're recognizing and we're witnessing that there's a rhyme and order to Yahweh. But there is rhyme and order to Yahweh. And we become in that purpose when we see how he set it up from the very beginning with Moses. By having given him a name. Genesis. 3:1 is fine, because this is where we begin to learn about Yahweh and what he set up for us to learn about him by. Because we have to know a name, because without a name, you're going to be lost in the water. And therefore, we were told and instructed in order to start, we start at this bush, and we're going to catch it here in John 3, or now, Exodus 3
Exodus
and 1.
Exodus 3.
Exodus 3 and 1, right?
Got it. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, mm-hmm. the priest of Midian,
mm-hmm.
and he led the flock to the backside of the desert.
Now Moses is a shepherd at this time at 80 years old, and he's leading them, his flock of his father, doing the will of his father, if you would, as a type and a shadow. Jethro was a king of Midian. And Moses was likened to his son, or likened to Yahshua as into the son of Yahweh. You follow? Tending to his sheep, his father-in-law's sheep. It's only a correlation in order to bring you up to an idea about metaphors, similes, analogies, and correlations that we're using in order to shore up your confidence about the purpose and plan of Yahweh through various events. And now at this time we have Moses at 80 years old on the backside of the mount tending to a flock of sheep. Read.
And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and mm-hmm. came to the mountain of Elohim,
yes.
even to Horeb.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
That's right.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn.
It's not burning because this is a vision that he's having at this time, at this burning bush. It's a vision. He's looking at it. He's divinely inspired to look and see this bush that's not burning. Read.
And when Yahweh saw that he turned to side to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I.
Yes.
And he said, draw not nigh hither. Mm-hmm. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground.
Okay.
Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob.
And that Elohim is a title now. And he's telling them that he's the Elohim of the patriarchs. Read.
And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
Yes.
And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people.
Now he's hearing Yahweh. He saw Elohim and hid his face, but now he's hearing Yahweh. And Yahweh's saying what?
I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt.
Right.
And I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows.
That's right.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the land of the hand of the Egyptians.
Now look, we said Yahweh is pure spirit and without shape and form, inscrutable. And Yahweh perceived that man would not be able to understand him in this state. Therefore, he had to come down as Yahweh Elohim. And he perversely had also came down at 30 years old. And he's projecting himself now to Moses at the burning bush. And he's witnessing this that he's already set up some 400 years prior to this event going on, because he gave Moses or Abraham a promise 430 years before the law of Moses was given. You follow? So now you have Moses, he have fled out of Egypt. He tarried out here for some 40 years. And now we're at this bush, and he's going to be told to come back down into Egypt in order to deliver his people, because it was already set up that he was going to make Abraham a great nation out of Isaac and out of Jacob. Jacob's name changed to Israel, and these 70 souls came down, and now we're 400 years into time, and we're talking about a name. Read.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land.
See, I am Elohim has come down, or Yahshua has come down, or Yahweh has come down, and telling him what he's going to do, because he's put him there, and he's going to deliver his people. Read.
Unto a good land and a large.
Okay.
Unto a land flowing with milk and honey.
Yes.
Unto the place of the Canaanites.
Yes.
And the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me.
Okay.
And I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them.
Yes.
Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt.
That's what makes them think they're so chosen. But nonetheless, we're looking at a principle and a pattern by which Yahweh set up that he's going to deliver his people. Read. Not Moses' people, but Yahweh's people. Read.
And Moses said unto Elohim.
Now listen to what Moses says unto Elohim. Remember, Elohim is a title, right? A divine title that Yahweh gave himself. So now we want to find out what Moses is about to tell this Elohim. Read.
And Moses said unto Elohim, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?
Moses is humble. Man, I really don't have to do that task. Read.
And he said, certainly I will be with thee.
That's right.
And this shall be a token unto thee that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve Elohim upon this mountain.
He's saying he's going to serve Elohim. That makes sound like this is Elohim that he's going to serve, right? That we're going to serve Elohim. Because that makes it sound like a name. Keep reading.
And Moses said unto Elohim.
Moses said to Elohim, what?
Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel,
okay,
and shall say unto them,
okay,
the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto,
mm-hmm,
you. And they shall say to me,
yes,
what is his name?
The children of Israel is going to say unto Moses, hey, what is his what?
What is his name?
Hey, if we're talking, if Elohim was a name, and Elohim's telling Moses he's going to send, Elohim is talking to Moses that he's going to send him down into Egypt, it's not by the name of Elohim, because Elohim is not a name. Because otherwise you wouldn't have Moses. Reread this statement again, please.
And Moses said unto Elohim,
mm-hmm,
behold, when I come unto the children of Israel,
mm-hmm,
and shall say unto them,
mm-hmm,
the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you,
mm-hmm,
and they shall say unto me, mm-hmm, what is his name? What shall I say unto them?
Elohim? You know his, not his name. His name is not Elohim. His title. What name am I going to give him now? And that's why I say this is the knowing why this is not a Trinitarian concept. This is a divine unity of the Spirit and understanding where and who and what and why is talking. That's the knowing about knowing the one true El and Yahshua Messiah who Yahweh has sent. Now skip on down to about 14, I think it is. Maybe 13. I don't want to get with the ire, Asher, ire at this particular time because it says, I will be what I will to be, or Ire Asher Ire. This is a descriptive title about the unity of what Yahweh is capable of being, which is whatever he wills to be.
15.
But verse. I want to get to the name, is what I'm focusing on right now. The name of our Father. Read.
And Elohim said, moreover, okay, unto Moses,
mm-hmm,
thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, Yahweh,
mm,
the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob.
You see how that Yahweh Elohim is Yahweh Elohim that came to them and not a separate entity? It is Yahweh Elohim. And he's telling Moses the name you're going to go to the children of people to deliver them with is Yahweh. Not I am. Not I will be what I will to be, or this is the descriptive title about Yahweh, but it's by the name of Yahweh. Read. And for how long is this name going to be in existence for?
Okay. Has sent me unto you.
Mm-hmm.
This is my name forever.
Forever.
And this is my memorial.
And a memorial.
All generations.
Into all generations that's going to come out of Abraham's loins, if you would, since the beginning, because we're dealing with one Yahweh and one Spirit. So understanding that this Yahweh Elohim is one and the same, with a purpose of Elohim being super incorporeal, whereby he's going to come to us in visions and teach us by revelations, and understanding that when the children of Israel came out of the land of Egypt, Moses was called atop of Mount Sinai and was shown a tabernacle pattern. And it's this tabernacle pattern that Elohim transformed into this threefold sanctuary, invisible sanctuary, because this is within Moses' consciousness that he's seen this tabernacle at first. And he's told Exodus 25 and 8, please. He's told to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. And we express that this tabernacle is a pattern of heavenly things, not physical, carnal things. Although we use this tabernacle pattern as a sly rule or as an instrument in order to prove one's existence, how we are made in the likeness and image of our Creator. Elohim said, go ahead and grab
and let 25. Them.
Go up to 23 or 7 or 6, please.
I'll start at 1. I mean 6. Oil for the light, spices for anointing oil, and for sweet incense,
mm-hmm,
onyx stones, and stones to be set in the ephod,
mm-hmm,
and in the breastplate, and let them make me a sanctuary
right.
that I may dwell among them.
See, Elohim's going to, they're going to make him a sanctuary so that Elohim can dwell among them. Because around this sanctuary, you have the 12 tribes of Israel. You follow? And it's in the midst, you have Elohim that's going to dwell with them. And they're going to follow this cloud. And so symbolically, we're looking at our body as the tabernacle. Remember, we have a light in us. And that light lighteth every man. But now we have this pattern, if you would, because we have 12 extremities around our tabernacle. Or our head region, our chest region, and our abdominal region. These three parts make up the one body. We can exist without these appendages here, right? But yet, this is a type and a shadow to see how this tabernacle was told to Moses to have them to build. Keep reading there in 25, please.
According to all mm-hmm. that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle, and the instruments thereof, mm-hmm. even so shall ye make it.
Okay. Down to 40. Was that 9?
Yeah.
Down to 40, please.
And look that thou make them after the pattern,
mm-hmm.
which was showed thee in the mount.
So it's in the mount that Moses has received this by divine vision and revelation. And for 40 years, they tarried with this tabernacle. And as long as they had this tabernacle in operation, they were going to be guarded. They were going to be fine within this purpose by which Yahweh has set up, and we tabernacle within our body. Because how we're set up with a most holy place being our head region, a holy place being our chest region, and our court roundabout being our abdominal region. And we can go through with these 9 primary furnishings within our body that correlate perfectly with the 9 divine vessels that are in the tabernacle. Whereby it's giving us witness as to the purpose of this pattern and plan in order to have the knowledge about one Yahshua the Messiah, in order to have some correlation in how we are made in the image and likeness of Elohim, which is our Father, in a supercorporeal state whereby we can witness and see and know him by his purpose, pattern, and plan, which has been drawn out in various charts in order to give us the confidence of how these events in time are set up according to that pattern. And it's set up by 1 Corinthians 15th chapter, first verse. And when we got these events set up in a threefold pattern, because everything is set up by a threefold pattern, is why Yahweh has set up this tabernacle pattern for a witness, so that we can have some confidence and faith that this universe, this world, and our reality is just not haphazard. There is an Elohim that's operating everything from the minutest particle, or atom, made up of a proton, electron, and neutron, through the cell that's broken up in three parts. In order to give us the confidence in this Holy Spirit, not the man Yahshua decided, but the Holy Spirit, because that's what it says under the name chart, that we're looking at a Holy Spirit, and not if they had that opportunity back in, and they missed him. They hung him on the cross, the whole world, by purpose, for him to be able to usher in the New Testament or a new covenant that's going to be written in our heart and mind based off the gospel. And we need to find out what the gospel is. And if we can go ahead and read, please.
Moreover, brethren, mm-hmm. I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received.
Now, this is the gospel that Saul has preached and they have received, just as we received the gospel, just as they received the gospel some 50 days after the death of Yahshua Messiah. Read.
And wherein ye stand.
Wherein we stand. In order to what? Have a testimony, have a witness to that which we were shown. We didn't make it up. We were shown it by patterns, by revelations, by a testimony. And this is the gospel. Read.
by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto
you. Now we're saved by that. Eternal life is to know the gospel, which is going to be unto salvation for us that read.
Unless ye have believed in vain.
Believed in vain. Believed with an empty heart. Believed in a poo-poo idea that some guy or some spirit is going to come down and transform and then having one manifestation and become into a second manifestation. How am I going to believe that? And I see the witnesses by the pattern and by all the evidence that's ever been created on the world to know about the one true El and Yahshua whom Yahweh has sent. Keep reading. I'll be right down.
For I delivered unto you first of all. Start again. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received.
Okay.
How that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures.
That's a how he died. That's a knowing how he died. The life eternal is to know. You gotta know, how he died. Read.
And that he was buried.
He died and he was buried. How was he buried? What does it point to that he was buried? Read.
And that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures.
And that he rose again the third day. This wasn't the first time he's making the statement that he was here, because he said and again. According to what? The scriptures. Not the New Testament. But the scriptures, the same scriptures that Yahshua Messiah himself said, you search them, but they are they that testify of me. So how did he die? How was he buried? And how did he resurrect since the beginning of time? And all down through times, through the ages and dispensations until this time. Read.
And was seen of by Kepha, and then by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present day, but some have fallen asleep.
And so we are here now to give a witness to the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah based off the 4,000 years by which he came in to fulfill and to move and pass out of the way, whereby we might have eternal life in the spirit law of one Yahshua the Messiah. If you got anything out of this lecture, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love. For our next speaker, I'd like to call on the president of the Ontario branch, Dr. Christopher Williams.
Good afternoon, class.
Good afternoon.
As always, the pleasure and honor to stand before the body of Yahshua Messiah. happy Father's Day to you fathers out there. And as he says, single mothers. You got to haze me in my as I'm up here, Mom, really? Yeah, I see how it is. No, she didn't. I saw you. It was you. I appreciate the first two speakers and everything they had to say, and I'd like to try to stay in the same vein and pull out a couple of different things, especially that was on my heart and mind. Given today being Father's Day, I figure let's focus on the Father and talk about some of the things that Yahweh has done to not only prove the authenticity of his existence, but the how that Marlon was talking about, how he did it, and, you know, show the why, right? So if you can get me Romans 1:19 and 20, and then the scripture lesson, and then also actually just get me 1 and 26, and then also get me John 1 and 1. And then we'll go from there.
Romans.
Because there's a theme when it comes to talking about Yahweh, right? So Yahweh, his name means he who brings into existence whatever exists, right? Meaning he is the creator of all things. And when we talk about all things, we talk about things that is visible and invisible. Things you can see, things you can't see, things that are known and unknown. If it exists, it exists by the will of Yahweh. Now, we can talk about the things we can see, but those things that we can't see, such as spirit, that's where we struggle, right? Because we have these five senses that we use to understand what we know to be true, right? So Yahweh is trying to communicate with us via the spirit, because that's how he deals with a man. He doesn't deal with your fleshy concepts and opinions. He deals with your spirit, your soul. That's how he communes with you. If you've ever been caught up in the spirit, that's Yahweh talking to you, right? Where are we at?
Romans 1:19.
Please.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Now, Yahweh has showed it unto them. So that means not only did he take the time to create a creation, but now he's going to show his creature within the creation how he did it. How did he do that? Read.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Now, what are the invisible things of him? Well, he is the source and substance of spirit. Yahweh is spirit. We read it earlier, John 4:24. Yahweh is spirit. He and they that worship him in spirit must worship him in spirit and truth, right?
Right.
So we're going to identify his spirit, which is nothing more than divine intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, and justice, foundation, power, and strength. Now, of all these things that he is, he did it because of love, out of love for us, for his creation. That's going to be today's theme, love. Not something we feel it to be, but what it is. Now, a lot of people seem to think that love is something we feel. I'm so in love with you. We do it all the time. I just love my son. I just love my girlfriend. I love my wife. I love my husband. But what does that really mean when we say that? I can look at this display with Sean, his son, and say he loves his son. Because of what? He's comforting him? No, that's not what tells me that he loves his son. I got four brothers that my mom gave birth to outside of me. And I can tell you my mom loves her boys. But it wasn't because she just loved and kissed all over us. That wasn't how she displayed her love for us. My mom slaved away to provide for them. Sean gets up every day and does a job that he probably wished he didn't have to do to provide for his kids. Yahweh created a creation for his creature. That's love. Pure spirit, just chilling like a villain. In a perfect harmony. And then decided to create a creation for what? Real quick, Exodus 9:14? Or 9:16?
16. Exodus 9:16. And in very deed, for this cause have I raised thee up, for to show in thee my power, that my name may be declared throughout all the earth.
That's why he did it. That's why he did it. So he can reveal himself to himself. Reading
Romans.
Romans.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made.
Now he said the invisible things of him are clearly understood by the things that are made. So what did he make? He created a pattern. Right? And when he presented his pattern to Moses in Mount Sinai in a vision, Moses is probably Greek to him. Like, what are you showing me? So, because when he sees this anthropomorphic being, he just sees the shape and form of a man in a vision. So then Yahweh decided, hey, let me break this down and show you this pattern. And then he went on to explain that pattern for the next 7 chapters of Exodus. Right? So then from this pattern, he transforms back into himself and draws the creation out of that in a vision for Moses' benefit and breaks it down by day. Now, when Yahweh created or divested himself of this pure spirit state and took on shape and form as Yahweh Elohim, that was the creation in and of itself. Yahweh created a creation and then executed his purpose himself as Yahweh Elohim.
Right.
That is what he did. Mm-hmm. And so that we can have an understanding of Yahweh Elohim, he broke it down into 9 furnishings, 3 compartments, and 7 steps to show the operation and the authenticity of that pattern. So then he went a step further. This creation was patterned after the tabernacle. We have a mantle, a crust, and a core. Just like Yahweh is, you have Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. We have a head, chest, and abdominal region to point to the holy, most holy place, and court round about. And then we broke this body down and showed how this body lines up perfectly to this tabernacle pattern. Exactly. So that if they try to take this away, they can't take you away.
Right. Good point.
So he said, I'm going to create a creation so you understand the invisible things in me. That takes love, folks. That takes divine intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge to put that together so that we can have an understanding about who our creator is. Marlon just said he doesn't do anything haphazardly. He did this from the beginning of beginnings. John 1:1.
In the beginning was the Word.
Read.
And the Word was with Yahweh. And the Word was Yahweh.
Now, if you paid attention to the moderation, we talk about how the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit are one, right? And now, if you look at this chart, we show how the Word lines up to Elohim. This is Yahweh in his creative state, his anthropomorphic being state. Now, when he's the Son, he is Yahshua returning back into heaven. But when he's executing this purpose in the form of creation, that is the Word doing the operation. It's interchangeable, depending on what the context of what he's doing. Now, he said in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh.
Right.
So that's him telling you that everything that you see is me.
Right.
Now, he created not just this physical earth that we stand on. He created this stand here, these chairs, this Clorox bleach, this water. He created you. So, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
So when he said Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of his way, he was talking about this Word here.
Right.
Read.
All things were made by him.
Did he say some things were made?
Oh.
No. You know what? The devil, he didn't make him.
All things.
You sure? Maybe the Bible is just a typo. Right? He said all things were made by him. Read.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
So that means there's no other self-existing deity outside of Yahweh. So that means the devil or Satan is not operating free and on his own. He is there according to a purpose. Now we read it earlier, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, there is no light or understanding in them. Now, in order to have some understanding or to have that light, In order to have light, you need a positive and a negative wire. Do we not?
Right.
So that means you need a righteous spirit and an unrighteous spirit to have some understanding about the righteousness of Yahweh. So he created a worthy adversary, himself, to operate the mystery of iniquity so that we can have some understanding about this one Yahweh. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Read. John.
In him was life.
Uh-huh.
And the life was the light of men.
Now he said in him was life. So there was no life on this earth until he came forth, right? Now in Genesis 1:1, can you grab that, Sean? Hold your finger there, please, Eunice. We're not done with you.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
So now we talk about the beginning of beginnings on the word, right? Now in the beginning of Moses' vision, because Yahweh is showing Moses the execution of how this occurred. See, Moses didn't talk about from here to here. Moses talking about from here to there, because that was what his purpose was, to talk about one beginning. Now, John on Isle of Patmos is going to talk about the beginning of beginnings to encompass and confirm that which Moses had already seen. Now, you can read in Revelation how he says, hey, everything that you just saw about the days of creation, don't write that. It's been written already. That ain't what you're here to do. I want you to tell a different version of the story. That's why you don't hear John talking about it. But if you paid attention to what was written in Revelation, you can see the difference. You can see the correlation between the days of creation if you paid attention. But we're not getting into that because we're talking about something different. Now, read, Sean.
And the earth became without form and void.
So we had this amalgamation of a conglomeration of amalgamating mass sticking in and out of the water, right? So just without form and void. And now Yahweh Elohim is going to shape and form this creation right in front of Moses. Day one, he did what? Read.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep, mm-hmm. and the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters.
Read.
And Elohim said, let there be light. And
so
there
he creates light on day one. He separates the light from the darkness with the twilight and the mist, right? Read.
And Elohim saw the light, that it was good.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim called the light day,
mm-hmm.
and the darkness he called night.
Read.
And the evening and the morning were the first day.
So now he's going to break down each day for Moses until he gets to the sixth day. Now, some might ask, why you wait to the last minute to bring in man? Because I just know me. I take credit for everything. I did it. That's what we do, right? You at work, you create a way to fix things, and your boss take credit for it. Oh, my operation's doing really well. Erica did it, but we're going to take credit for it because we want the promotion. Don't want to promote you. That's what we do, right? Happens all the time. But karma's one of those mamma jammas, right? Next thing you know, he gets passed over, you get the promotion, now he's working for you. Now it's your turn to give credit to where credit's due. But y'all always like, listen, man, I'm a self-existent deity. I got this. I did all this. None of y'all did anything, right? And so he creates this creation, and by a pattern, mind you, we have it broken down in that way for a reason. Now, if you look on this chart, we show this heart here, and it looks just like this one here. Now, when you understand the purpose of Yahweh, you understand that this is Yahweh Elohim in spirit, right? This is Yahweh Elohim, but we're not gonna understand this. So he took on shape and form of a man so that we can relate to him. So we have some understanding, right? Now, we have a chart. We call this theosophy. I don't want to get it. I don't want to get too far into that. But we have theosophy where if you was to cut this open, you can see the essence of Yahweh Elohim. But we're not doing that, right? But this is Yahweh Elohim in the spirit. And so that we can have an understanding who he is, he shows up as a man, as an anthropomorphic being in a vision. Now, you see this heart here showing that Yahweh Elohim Yahshua is present here, it's present here, it's present here. Until we get here, it's still present, right? Mm-hmm. But not until we get to here, it's separated. John 1:26.
John 1:26.
Read.
John answered them, saying, I baptize with water, but there's...
Oh, excuse me. I apologize. Genesis 1:26. Oh. Oof. Yeah. Man, I almost messed everything up, didn't I? My bad. Okay. Okay. John.
Genesis 1:26. And Elohim said, let us make man in our image, mm-hmm. after our likeness,
uh-huh.
and let them rule over the fish of the sea and mm-hmm. over the birds of the heavens.
So now he's creating man, or Adam, right here. Now Adam is created in the likeness and image of Yahweh Elohim, having both male and female parts. Because Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself, yet neither. Right? So he took the first man, Adam, make the masculine portion of the name. I don't want to diminish the he. I want y'all to think I got something against women here. So then he created woman. To show the feminine portion of the name. Now, Yahweh not being slack in his promise, you got Yahshua, right? And you have this man, Adam. Now, when this man, Adam, is created, he's created with both male and female parts. Now, in the second chapter of Genesis, Yahweh is going to take the rib or the womb out of the man and create woman, right? Now, it would appear that Yahshua is only representing the masculine portion of Yahweh's name. However, when you understand what this name means, it means Yahweh is salvation, right? Mm-hmm. That means the way, or the woman, is hidden in the man. No different than the woman being hidden in the man, Adam.
Right.
This being the first Adam, Yahshua being the second Adam, this is the degenerator, this is the regenerator. So he's not regenerating without the woman. He is both masculine and feminine, regenerating what was degenerated back here with Adam. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So he can't do anything without the feminine portion of the man, of the name. Just like we can't do anything without the woman. Showing that Yahweh is not leaving anyone out of the purpose and pattern of Yahweh, of the purpose, even anything out of the purpose. Meaning everyone, both male and female, is just as equally important when it comes to your salvation or with Yahweh. When he's talking about the sons, he's not saying delineating whether it's a gender issue. Right. He's saying, hey, I'm the father, you are my son, or you are my children. Mm-hmm. Not caring about your gender whatsoever. Just in case somebody got that sexist or misogynist idealism when it comes to the gospel, because that's not so. Right. Because the purpose is universal. He's not leaving anybody out. He don't care about your race, about your gender, about your sex, about your sexuality. He does not care. That is used to trip you up when it comes to the spirit. Because if we took everyone's skin off them and just separated the spirit from the physical body, we couldn't tell you male, female, gay, straight, Asian, black, turquoise, one leg, no legs, hermaphrodite, whatever the case may be. You couldn't tell. Spirit is spirit. And I begin this thing talking about Yahweh only gives a dang about your spirit. He doesn't care about anything else. So while we caught up in all this other nonsense that no one should care about, because Yahweh himself only cares about the spirit of the man, he's saving souls, not physical bodies. Right? Flesh and blood cannot enter the kingdom. Right? So he doesn't care about any of that. So why are we focused on that on earth? Why aren't we focusing on that, the spirit of the man? First John 2:18. I could be wrong.
Little children, it is the last time.
Hold on. It is little children, but I want to make sure it's right.
There's also 2:28.
Fifteen.
Okay. Love not the world, neither the things.
14. Start at 14, please.
14th verse. I have written unto you, fathers, because ye have known him from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of Yahweh abideth in you, and ye have overcome the wicked one. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him.
Mm-hmm.
For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of Yahweh abideth forever.
Mm-hmm.
Little children, it is the last time. And as ye have heard.
We're
that
good. I found out what it is.
All right.
3:18. Next page.
3:18.
Yeah.
My little children, let us not love in word.
That's right.
Neither in tongue.
So don't just tell me you love me. Men tell you anything to do what you want to do, right? That's what happens. Don't tell you anything. A preacher get up here and expound on these. I love y'all. Pay me. Stop asking me. Right? Read.
Let us not love in word, neither in tongue,
mm-hmm.
but in deed and in truth.
It is not love until you do something, until you declare it based on your actions. Because Yahweh so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He gave of himself. He divested of this heavenly state of ontological perfection for the love of his son. Son. Just read it. First, John 3:16. You got it, Eunice. Hold your finger there, because we're not done, because you might as well just go back to 3:1.
John 3:16.
Read it.
For Yahweh so loved the world.
Read.
That he gave his only begotten son.
Read.
That whosoever believeth in him.
Read.
Should not perish, but have everlasting life.
So if you so ever believe in him, you won't perish. But Yahweh didn't just leave it to just blind faith. He decided, you know what? Let me establish their faith. So he started with Adam. And he executed his purpose through this man so that we could see it for ourselves. And they said, you know what? If they didn't get it with Adam, let me go to Noah. And so he gave us Noah. And he executed his pattern through that man. And he said, you know what? Maybe they don't get it with Noah. He brought you Melchizedek and Abraham. And he showed his pattern through that man and many other prophets, just in case you didn't get it. Then, to even further show his love of his creation, he went and did a rerun himself of 4,000 years of people, places, and things in 33 and a half years, and then documented it. But it wasn't just using a man, it was the Holy Spirit himself. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send, whose name? My name, mm-hmm. will teach you all things and bring all things back to remembrance whatsoever I've done said unto you. So the Holy Spirit is operating throughout the ages and dispensations using men to execute his purpose, pattern, and plan. Because Yahweh so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. Yahweh, not doing things without any witnesses, not only divested of himself and created the creation in the form of Yahweh Elohim, but according to John's writings, and he says, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. So he did it here. And then just to further put a nail in the coffin, he did it here. If that's not love, I don't know what love is. Read.
John 3 and 1.
1 John 3 and 1.
1 John 3 and 1. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us.
What manner? Read.
That we should be called the sons of Yahweh.
How are we able to be called the sons of Yahweh when we didn't earn any of this? We didn't do anything special to get any of this.
That's right.
We just read how he gave his only begotten son before the love of his creation. Because he so loved the world that he gave him to us. And we didn't earn it. In fact, at every turn, we failed him. Mm-hmm. Our kids fail us all the time. They steal. They lie. They choose not to get good grades. They get fired and want to come move in your house. Then they steal from you again. You let them borrow your car, they don't put gas in it. They crash your car. They're just a burden. But guess what? Ooh, man, that was close. Eric, you almost got fired. But guess what? Because Yahweh so loved the world, we love our world, which is our children, right? That's what we're here for, to procreate. And listen, if you don't procreate, you're going to love something. Our job is to love one another. Is that not one of the commandments? So Yahweh so loved the world, he gave us his only begotten son, and then he went and just displayed this love for us, which we didn't earn. And yet, we worry about a guy named Trump, or why someone didn't like our page on Facebook, or how come he didn't call me on my birthday? Right? Love is an action. It is not how we feel about the person next to us. Don't get me wrong. Sometimes I get the feels for some people, man. It is what it is. That is our flesh. We can't help it. But Yahweh has given us the power of discernment, right? And he says, you want to try the spirit by the spirit. I can tell what kind of spirit is in a man based on his deeds. Not just those superficial deeds like, hey, it's Christmas. Look at me. I'm passing out the money and just giving the money, right? No. How about on a Tuesday? Hey, man, you know what? Let's go get something to eat because I actually see you hungry. That's the man I want to hang out with. That's love. Unconditional love. The love that we didn't earn, we just gave it. See, when you give love, love comes back to you tenfold. You don't have to sit there and buy anyone's love. I'd rather you just show up for me than pay for me. Mm-hmm. Right? That's how you know someone really gives a dang about you, when they actually show up for you. Don't we show up for our friends and family and kids? I know I do. Yeah. These dang kids been driving me insane. I got a kid right now drive my ride like he's like Don Juan. I'm paying the bill. He ain't offering no money, ain't get my oil changed, nothing. I know when I get the car back, it's going to be worse than when I gave it. Those are our kids. But we love them anyway, right? We wipe their butts when they poop, when they kid, when they babies. They act like they don't know us when they get older. They grow up. They leave our house, forget to call us on Wednesdays, right? How can you not call me? Sorry, Ma, I'll call you tomorrow. Do I not do it? We all do it. We all have our day in the sun, right? That's what parents do. That's what kids, that's what parents have to endure, right? What do you think? Yahweh don't endure that with us? I mean, be fruitful and multiply, but don't touch that tree. And touch it anyway. Hey, man, I'm going to go fight a fight for you. Just go survey the land. Man, we can't do it. I just said I'm going to fight the fight for you. Did I not conquer Egypt for you? We get up here, man, we want a king like everybody else. Really? Okay. Right? That's all we do. All we do is fail. But he loves us anyway. You have to believe that he did exactly what he said he did. And then we can have what manner of love this is. Read.
Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of Yahweh. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not.
Read.
Beloved, now are we the children of Yahweh, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is.
Now, Dr. Kinley always professed that I'm Yahweh. Don't be offended. So are you. The difference is I'm conscious of it. You are not. That's all that scripture is talking about. Once you have a realization about the spirit of the living Elohim within you, then you will be free of sin and death. You will no longer be in bondage in your mind. As Morpheus says, I'm here to free your mind, right? That's one for those Matrix people. Fourth is coming out. I'm excited, right? That's what he's here to do. This gospel is going to free your mind from this darkness that we've been steeped under. When you truly understand the greater and more perfect tabernacle that we're dwelling in, you can see when you're in bondage, just like the Israelites were here in Egypt. But he sent himself to free them from this bondage, just like he's freeing you when you understand and believe the gospel that's being preached unto you. Not because someone said it, because they proved it to your satisfaction according to the scriptures. A lot of people can boast about things and make it sound really good. Right? We call that spin, right? But can they prove it? Is it sustainable? Is it infallible? Does it line up to the pattern? Because scripture always lines up to this pattern, right? Read.
And every man that hath this hope in him purify himself, even as he is pure. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sin. And in him is no sin.
Now he said, sin is a transgression of the law. And the only law they had at that time was the law of Moses. The Messiah was here to take away that law, because that law was a burden unto them, because he gave his only begotten son. Because by sin, death reigned throughout the world, right? But because a man with no sin had to die the sacrificial death, so he could take sin out of the way. So if there's no law, there is no sin in this age. Now, that's a hard pill for some people to swallow, because people still think that there's such thing as a sin according to this law. That's what they believe. But that means they don't believe the gospel according to 1 Corinthians 15 and 1. Don't get it. I'm saying the gospel, how the Messiah died and was raised and buried according to the scriptures for our sins. They don't believe that. If they still truly believe that there's sin in this age. So either you believe it or you don't.
Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not.
Mm-hmm.
Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither know him. Little children, let no man deceive you.
Mm-hmm.
He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the adversary, for the adversary sinneth from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
For this purpose, the Son of Yahweh was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the adversary.
Okay. Last scripture, and I'll sit down. 1 Corinthians 13 and 4.
13 and 4. Love suffereth long.
What?
Love suffereth long and is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth it not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unbecomingly,
mm-hmm.
seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth.
Now, it doesn't roll off the tongue when we read it out of this book, but however, this is the true definition of what love is, right? Because we talked about earlier how people think that love is a feeling. But love is all about the truth. Love is not trying to bring evil or iniquity to anybody. But sometimes it would appear that love is hard. No, sometimes love is telling you, hey, you are jacked up. You need to fix that. That's hard. I just know from experience, nobody likes to see the truth about themselves. But that's love. Mm-hmm. One of the best people to ever tell me truth about myself was my father.
I'm sure.
I mean, listen, if telling me the truth was the equivalent of his love, that man loved the hell out of me. I'm going to be honest with you. I mean, he told me more about me than I want to hear. Okay? So, I wish he could have had a little bit more tact with it, but that just wasn't his way. Okay? Especially with me. Maybe some other people, but not with me. Right? But, but he did it out of love. Like, everything he did was out of love. I could honestly say that. Like, he'll tell me. He goes, yeah, Chris, there's some times I whooped your butt, and you probably didn't deserve it. But I did it anyway, because I figured down the line you're going to need it anyway. That's how he treated me. And I got it. And I was like, who tells their kid that? He did. It was funny. There was one day after class in Pasadena. It was a Friday night. He had actually spoke that night. And, we're getting dressed, getting ready for bed, and I just happen to be in the hallway. And he goes, hey, Chris, you know I love you, right? Yeah, you're my dad. Yeah, okay. And it was the most uncomfortable display of love from my dad. I just couldn't understand why he did that. That just seemed uncanny for him. It just didn't seem right. But to tell me, hey, man, you made a mistake. I could bail you out of jail right now, but I need you to learn this lesson. I'll see when you get out. That seemed natural to him. She was hotter than fish grease. Oh, man, she wanted to kill somebody. But guess what? Said leave him in there. He'll be fine. I was. Believe me, I was hotter than fish grease. But it was a lesson to be learned. And I learned a heck of a lesson. And from that lesson, I could teach my sons how to avoid or be avoid those pitfalls.
Right.
That's why he did it.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I got a lot of butt whoopings over the years, and I thought it was about the action, about getting my butt kicked. No, it was something that I need to learn in that lesson. Mm-hmm. 'Cause guess what? Life kicks your butt in many forms. Sometimes in disappointment, sometimes in strife, but there's something to be learned from those lessons. It is what it is. And that is the love that that our parents give to us, no different than the love that our Father has done for his creation. So on this Father's Day, please give love. Not the love that we feel inside, but true love indeed. Not what we say, but what we do. I hope and trust you got something well said today. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Dr. Williams. That will conclude today's lecture. We don't have any announcements today, so we hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m., and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something truthful about your Heavenly Father. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.
Recording.